Welcome back to the Hidden Structures Bootcamp series. Today we will be looking at 11 card packets. So we're back to odd size packets. And as you know, odd size packets have their own set of wonderful properties and characteristics versus even size packets. So here's a reminder of the main principles that we've been slowly working through in this series. Overcoding, Lone Survivor, Klondike Shuffle, Face-Up Cards, LR Dealing, and Other Effects. Now, today we're going to begin with the Lone Survivor principle, okay? And let me just bring up quickly a YouTube video that presents this idea and explains how to derive the general formula for this Lone Survivor idea relative to either the down under or under down shuffles. So this video here is produced by Numberphile, and as you can tell, there's 6.1 million views. So I think that's evidence that there's something of interest here. So they go through a complete derivation of the Lone Survivor formula and calculations that we'll be showing you today. So I encourage you to watch this in its entirety. It's only about 14 minutes long. Now, I know that we have been using the Lone Survivor principle and have talked about it in some detail in previous videos, but I don't think I've ever actually laid out explicitly the formulas for the down-under deal and the under-down deal relative to the lone surviving card at the end of those dealings. Okay, so given a packet of N cards, if N is equal to 2 to the S plus L, where S is maximal, then the lone survivor for the down-under deal will be 2 times L. That's the position of where you'll find the lone surviving card in our case. And for the under down deal, the position of the lone surviving card will be 2L plus 1. Okay? And if you give it just a few moments of thought, you'll realize that there really should be a connection between these two formulas, and that in fact they should be off by just 1, which they are. Now, since 11 is equal to 2 to the 3rd plus 3, L is equal to 3. Hence, the lone survivor for the down-under deal is going to be 2 times L, which comes out to be 6, which is the middle position in an 11-card packet. Very, very nice. So the middle card is the lone surviving card relative to the down-under deal. Now, the only other time we have seen this in this series is for a packet of 5 cards. So this truly is a very rare occurrence. Now, the lone survivor for the under-down deal is the card in the 7th position, 2L plus 1. Which is not helpful in general. Okay, let's go ahead and illustrate this, and we'll take advantage of our diagram of shuffles for odd size packets here on the left. Okay, so let's say I just grabbed 11 random cards. Hopefully there's 11 of them. So let me just point out, you know, some simple things you could do with this. So let's say these are the cards, and you would like to reveal the Ace of Spades at the end, which happens to be on top right now. The Ace of Spades is a very popular card, as you might imagine. But the problem is, it's at the top. And we need it in the middle position for the lone survivor principle to apply here, for the down-under deal to bring it up to the top as the last card. Okay, well, if you look at our diagram here on the left, If we have an odd size packet, which we do, the top card can be moved to the middle card by a number of different ways, actually. Now, perhaps the easiest way is to perform what's called a Charlier 1. That's what the CH1 is an abbreviation for, Charlier 1. Well, you've seen this one before, I believe. So this is where you push one card over, and then the bottom card, just one, goes on top, top card goes on the bottom, bottom card goes on top, top to bottom, bottom to top, top to bottom, bottom to top, top to bottom, bottom to top, top to bottom. Now, believe it or not, the Charlier 1 will always move the top card of an odd size packet to the middle. Always, always, okay? And once again, I don't think this is known. Even using the Charlier 1 shuffle was an idea I came up with, and it's just not in the literature. But it's such a useful shuffle, as we can see right here. And what's really helpful is look over here. Once we have it in the middle position, there's really only one nice way that I am aware of, in general, that you can move the middle card to the bottom. And it's by performing another Charlier 1. Isn't that wonderful? So, well, maybe I should confirm that the Ace of Spades is in the middle from that last action. We have five above, five below the Ace of Spades. Now, if we perform one more Charlier 1, it will be at the bottom. So you go move one over, and then one card from the bottom, top to bottom, bottom to top, 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 and then this one goes on the bottom. Okay, well, we, according to that diagram, we know what the bottom card is. It's the Ace of Spades, okay? So this diagram will allow you to just move cards around, and now we can go back up to the middle position if we like. Just come over here, up to the middle position. And incredibly, ironically, if we perform the down under deal for an odd size packet, it will move the bottom card, which is the one we're wanting in the middle, it will move it to the middle. How amazing is that? Okay, so now if we do the down under, down, 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 under, down. Set the last one on top. That Ace of Spades will now be in the middle position. Okay? Amazing, amazing, amazing. So we have five cards below it and five above it. Okay? Okay, so that's where we need it. We need the Ace of Spades in the middle. Well, let's just recall one other important principle. Overcodings. We have an odd number of cards. The middle card is the one we want to keep in the middle. Well, we know that overcodings of the cards leave the middle card where it is. So once again, before even performing this down under deal to finish, we could actually perform a number of personalized overcodings, as we saw last time. Okay, so you could ask the spectator for, there's so much we can do, isn't there? Yeah, so we can do some personalized overcodings. So if we count out more than half the cards, which would be what, six or more, that middle card stays right where it is. So once again, we could use the spectator's favorite day of the week. And maybe they say it's Tuesday for some strange reason. So you could spell T-U-E-S-D-A-Y, Tuesday. Well, that's going to leave the middle card alone because Tuesday has more than 6 letters in the name. There you go. Tying it in further with something that we've learned, we know that for packets of size 8, 9, 10, or 11, if we hypercoat the name of any of the 52 cards, it will leave the packet alone. Okay? So you could ask the spectator either for their favorite card, or you could give them the choice and say, well, I personally would like to use the Ace of Spades for this next step, but if you feel strongly about a different card, let me know what it is. And so they will either say, yeah, Ace of Spades is fine, and then you would perform 2 identical hypercoats, which would leave the packet alone, actually, entirely. Or if they choose a different one, perhaps in an attempt to thwart you, like, okay, there's something about the Ace of Spades. I'm not using that one. I'm going to try to trip this guy up. So they'll say a Queen of Clubs. So, okay, is that what you want? Really? Okay, Queen of Clubs. And then you would hypercoat that twice. Q-U-E-E-N-O-F-C-L-U-B-S. Q-U-E-E-N-O-F-C-L-U-B-S. Okay, well, I've done what you said. I was hoping to use the Ace of Spades, but you really wanted the Queen of Clubs. Oh, I hope that's fine. I just hope it doesn't ruin everything here. So whatever kind of misdirection you want to give. And then we can actually just now finish with the Down Under, and maybe you can justify it in explaining how wonderful the Down Under is and when it was discovered. In Australia, it made the headlines on state television because of just all these amazing things people were doing with this Down Under Shuffle. So let's check it out here. So, down, under, 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 down. How did we do? What is the lone surviving card of that very, very messy shuffle? The Ace of Spades. Boy, I'm glad you didn't agree with me in using the card name Ace of Spades. Otherwise, all would have been lost. Boy, and how do you just happen to choose the Queen of Clubs, which makes it work? How did you do that? Okay. So there's so many elements to this where if the spectator goes back in time, they're actually going to be more and more surprised by the outcome, thinking, well, now wait a second, if I had done this, it would have been different. If he had done that, it would have been different. Okay. Now in the end, none of that's true. It wouldn't matter what card they chose for you to spell out, and it really wouldn't matter what day of the week they told you was their favorite, okay, and so forth, okay? So there's an invariance, we call it invariance here, that is protecting us and enabling us to finish as we intended to finish at the start, okay? So anyway, I just wanted to kind of review the lone survivor a little bit and kind of step through some of these calculations. Okay, the only other thing I was hoping to do today in this video is look at one of these other effects. So down here at the bottom, you'll see something that says two friends, three apart. Now, this is a simplified version of a larger routine that's called three friends, seven apart. And because it's been simplified down to a fairly small packet of cards, namely 11, it does make it more likely that the astute spectator might be able to see what's going on with this effect. So in practice, I don't necessarily recommend that you do this exact performance with 11 cards, even though it can be. But since it can be done with 11, I thought it would be a nice way to see what's going on with this whole routine. And maybe in practice, go ahead and use the three friends, seven apart, and you will really just completely surprise and delight the spectator. Okay, so what you need is, of course, we're working with 11 cards, so I just randomly chose 11 cards here, okay? And so what you would do is you would have the spectator look through these. Now, it's okay that you saw them as the performer, but you have the spectator now kind of go through these cards, and so let's pretend they're going through them, and you know, I'm not seeing what they're doing, let's say, and I'm asking them to remove two cards, and ideally two cards that they can remember if there's just one spectator. If there's two spectators, then maybe you can have each one of them randomly pull out one and remember just one card. Most people can handle that. So let's say you just have one spectator, and so the spectator goes through here and looks at the card. Oh, sorry, kind of fanning the wrong way for you. Okay, and oh, okay, so here's kind of an obvious choice you might see right there. The spectator might choose those two red queens. That's fairly easy to remember. So those that would be a good choice for them, but it really is their choice, okay? And then these remaining nine cards can be just mixed thoroughly, if you like. Okay? So they have these... Oh, I put them off the camera view. I'm sorry about that. So they have these two cards that they've chosen. They know they're red queens. I don't. I don't know anything about them, actually. Okay. And so how you begin here... Well, we've begun, but how you continue with this is you create three piles of three cards. Okay? Now, this routine is based on something called the free cut principle. And the free cut principle is a very powerful principle in the study of mathematical card magic, very useful. And I do want to point out that if you go to the Hidden Structures channel, I do have at least two, I think maybe even more, but two videos that use this principle. And once I explain it after this routine, you'll probably recognize where I used it. I don't know if it's going to make the performance any less surprising, because it may not, because of so many things going on there. But the one's called The Elusive Bank Robbers, okay? And then the other little video presentation on Hidden Structures is Miracle at Disney World. So I encourage you to watch those, and you'll see, two additional ways that you can use this free cut principle in fun and surprising ways. Okay, so I have three piles of three, and so what you need the spectator to do is choose either one of their cards and set it. Now we can give them the choice at the beginning. We'll be moving, and left to right or right to left, your choice. You want to go right to left? Okay. Okay, so what I need you to do is just set this one on top. They can do all of this, by the way. You don't have to do it for them. And then I need you to pick up as many of these cards as you like and set them on top of that first card of yours. And so maybe they choose a few here. You set them right there, a couple right there. And now they need to set their other card right there, okay? Once again, they're actually given a free choice to choose any number of cards from here and set it on top of that one right there, okay? Now, as a presentational device, it might be nice to create what's called a time delay. And a time delay means that you insert some comment or point out something that puts a little bit of distance between what we just did here and the next step. And when you do that, it's less likely people will kind of see what's going on. And I've already mentioned that with three cards, it's not too hard to see what's going on, but with seven, it is. So so at this point, their two cards are kind of buried, and so we're going to bury them further by putting these on top, and then this on top of there. And so now we have this packet of 11 cards. And what we can do that I don't do actually in the original three friends, seven apart, because I hadn't discovered the two identical hypercoding principle, we could use that here. You could say, now you might think that I have some idea as to where the cards are, where your cards are. And so what I'd like us to do is give you an important free choice to kind of mix these cards so that you and I, both, neither one of us will know really anything about where things are. And so I want you to randomly choose any one of the 52 cards, any one of the 52 card names, okay? Can be any of them. Seven of hearts? Are you sure? Is that the one you want? Seven of hearts? Okay, great. Seven of hearts. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to spell out seven of hearts twice, since you had two cards there that you've put into the pile. So seven of hearts, right? So SEVENOFHEARTS. Seven of hearts. One more time. You had two cards. SEVENOFHEARTS. Okay. Well, I think you agree that no one really could know where things are, or I certainly could not have these cards in a special arrangement, given that you just randomly chose one of the 52 card names to scramble these. Okay. Well, let's go on to the final stage of this little experiment here. So you chose those two cards because in your mind, somehow they're connected or easy to remember, or you know, maybe if they were real people, they would be friends in life or something. So what I want you to do is I want you to watch very carefully, because I'm going to be dealing the cards up, down, up, down, up, down. And as soon as you see one of your cards, let me know so I can stop, okay? So here we go. So this one's up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down. You haven't seen, are you sure you haven't seen either one of your cards? Okay, then up, okay. That's pretty amazing. Okay, so just confirm, yeah, none of your cards are there. That's fine. Okay, I'm believing you here. Okay, we'll do that one more time here. Up, down, up, down, up. Are you telling me, I did it kind of fast, did you mean to tell me to stop earlier? I kind of went through it quickly. I didn't give you a chance. I apologize. No? None of these are your cards. You chose two cards, and they're not here or here. You've got to be kidding me. There's two cards remaining. What are the chances that your two cards are those your two cards? How is that possible? You chose the seven of hearts to just mix these cards. You chose how many cards to kind of stack on top of these as we kind of buried them in this packet of 11 cards. How is it possible that your two cards are kind of the surviving cards of this process of dealing them up and down? Can you see what's going on? I would just love to get an explanation. So anyway, I always overdo any and all presentations that I give. So you can probably come up with a better one or more convincing one. So let's just take a moment and kind of look at what's going on here. And I want to focus on the free cut principle. We can't talk about everything that makes this work. I mean, I can point out what makes it work, but we're not going to take the time to prove why it works. Okay, so let's kind of back up here. So we'll now put your cards face up, even though they normally would be face down, right? Okay, and then we have these 9 cards, and I just, you know, set up 3 sets of 3. Okay, so the first thing to be aware of is we're going to give them the choice to set it here or there, you know, left to right or right to left. Okay, it doesn't matter. Okay, so essentially, so they were able to put their card right here, okay? And then they were free to choose any number from this middle pile. Now, I think you can see that in the larger performance, 3 friends, so you have 3 cards here, and then 7 in each pile. Well, with 7 cards, there's just so many more choices for moving different numbers over, right? With 3, there's 3 choices. Okay, but anyway, they were free to choose any number here. I'm trying to think. Did I do 2 or 1? I think I did a 2. Now, just think about, don't worry. If you've heard of the idea of filler cards. Now, filler cards are just, their purpose is to just be there in terms of a card count. They're taking up space. But we don't care like what order, we don't care what these are, okay? Or what order they're in, okay? So they pick up these cards and they set them on top. Maybe I'll go like that, okay? Even though you'd normally square it up. And then this, but remember, this one, these came from there, right? In fact, maybe I'll even do it like that, okay? And then this one goes on top of that one, right? And now they're free to choose, I think I chose just 1, free to choose any number to put on top here. So maybe we'll jog it out so we can kind of see what's going on, right? And then I suggested a little bit of a time delay, especially in this case with only 3 cards. But eventually what we're going to do is, and I've moved these, I've moved these down because these came from the same pile. We're going to stack in the opposite order that we've just moved, right? So these are going to go on top. We'll see what's happening. We have 3 cards on top of the queen. This card is on the bottom. It's going to be put on top of the cards from which it came, right? Oh, in fact, I guess since I'm doing a queen up, I should have done a queen up here. That would have been kind of helpful. Sorry about that. Okay, so going back to what I was trying to explain there. So the point is that there will be 3 cards on top of that second card that they've placed. Now, when I go to pick up this pile, there's 1 underneath the queen. And now there's 2 more underneath the queen, this top queen. So the queens have 3 between them, okay? And then, of course, there's 3 underneath the bottom queen, okay? So there's a 3, 3, 3. Now, it ends up that 3 is very, well, it's very special in many, countless ways. One of the reasons it's special is because it is a power of 2 minus 1. So 3 is 2 squared minus 1. And the reason for 7 apart is, well, you can see, 7 is 2 cubed minus 1. And so you can actually do 4 friends 15 apart. So you have 15 cards between, you know, these little friends, okay? Or, you know, however many decks you want to bring in, you can go bigger, right? So the key is, and this is referring to the free cut principle, because of how the cards will end up being stacked in the end, when they cut these little portions and move them onto the pile next to the one, you know, that on top of the card that was placed, at each stage, it will end up that it will preserve the fact that there are three underneath this first one, three between those two friends, and three above the second friend there. Okay? So that's the free cut principle, or at least a very quick look at it. And it's because the number of cards in between these is a power of 2 minus 1 in this case. And we have these two cards that we're going to reveal. What will happen is when you deal up, down, up, down. So it survives. Up, down, up, survives. Up, down, up. We do it again. Up, down, survives. Up, down, up. Okay, those are like gone, right? So this does have the advantage that it maybe helps you see kind of what's going on, but the disadvantage is it might help the spectators to see what's going on. So anyway, I recommend this one, but it is true that with 11 cards, we can do this classic effect where we have three piles of three and two friends that are that stick together to the end after this up-down dealing. Okay, well, I think, this is the rest of the instructions. I apologize. I do this so often. So here's just some more, here's some information I talked through. Expected to deal out three piles of three, and then continue, and then finish as in the original three friends, seven apart. Oh, and then let me just point out one more thing that's very powerful as well. We haven't been making use of it too much, actually, but it's really worth knowing. And it's the first shall be last, the last shall be first. Okay, so if you can just hang tight for just like two more minutes, let me just show you this, because this will be a wonderful illustration of this principle, and you'll see exactly why it's going to allow us to do everything that we needed to, even though it gives the illusion of the spectator mixing those cards. Okay, so I believe I've used this already, the FL squared F. So it's first shall be last, the last shall be first. Okay, so that's a name I came up with for this shuffle. Because it justifies the steps for it. Okay, so how this works is, now, of course, this one would normally not be face up, right? We wouldn't have face up, but I want you to see that this is going to work just fine. So what you do is you start dealing the cards out until the spectator says stop. So I dealt out two, and maybe they say stop, you know, and then I deal out a few more, and they say stop. Deal out a few more, stop, and then deal out the remaining ones. Okay, now the first shall be last. The last card dealt was this one over here. Okay, so the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. So the idea is you are stacking them in the opposite order in which they were being dealt. Okay. So first shall be last, last shall be first. Well, you can't even really see what's happened here. Well, if you rewind the video, you will. Because what's happened is the Queen of Diamonds and the Queen of Hearts have switched places. And it's because this first shall be last, last shall be first, is a packet reversal. That's all it is. Okay? So when they, you know, when you deal them out, you know, and they eventually say stop, you know, and you deal out a few more, stop, deal out a few more. That is a packet reversal. Okay, so if I stack them in the opposite order, first shall be last, last shall be first, you'll see that we're back to the original ordering. At least you'll see that for the queens. Okay, So hopefully you can kind of see what's going on here with this. It's a fairly deceptive little shuffle because what you're doing, so this is the top goes there, and so this is like second from the bottom, goes there, right? Okay, now this one follows that one, right? So it goes there, and then that one. So maybe focus on the queen, and then, in fact, let's just put out all the rest here, I guess. Well, when I stack in opposite orders, I'm putting that queen right back next to its neighbor. And it's true for all of the piles that you might deal out. You truly are just doing a packet reversal. Well, what that means then is any routine or structure that is invariant under a packet reversal, as is this one, you can do that shuffle, and it will not undermine the end result at all, even though technically it's reversed the order of all of the cards. And so if you think back to two cycles, mirrored structures and AMP structures, those are all invariant under reversal. You can reverse everything in, a two cycle or mirrored or AMP, and it's still a two cycle mirrored AMP. So those are all invariant under reversal, okay? And it's just a testament to the symmetry of the structures that we're looking at in these videos. So anyway, well, thanks for watching. That is certainly enough for today. And in the next video, we will look at 12 card packets.